Corps office. We were permitted to enter. Kathy got a little nosy and tried to get around on his side of the desk to see the pictures on his desk, and she was rebuked and told she had to come back. We went downstairs into the press room. You know the room I'm talking about. You've seen it many, many times on television. I just remember being amazed at how small that little room is. And then finally, we were carried to the Oval Office. We weren't permitted to enter the Oval Office, but we could stand there at the door and see the President's desk and all the other furnishings of the Oval Office. It was really exciting. It was thrilling to have approach God with a true heart in full assurance of faith. In the Bible, the verb to approach is often used to refer to the act of worshiping God, to approach God in worship. This would obviously include our praying to God. But we also approach God in other ways. We approach God in our singing, and especially, of course, in our sacred meal, the Holy Communion. And when we approach God in our worship, we're to approach Him with a trustful, faithful spirit, and with faith characterized by full assurance and confidence. Now, how can we, weak and sinful as we are, possibly approach God in such a manner? Well, the answer is given in the second part of verse 22. We know that our hearts have been sprinkled clean from a conscience that would torment us. Through Christ, God has done for us what He promised long ago through the prophet Ezekiel, chapter 36. Here's what God said. I will sprinkle clean water upon you, and you will be clean from all your uncleannesses. A new heart I will give you, and a new spirit I will put within you. And in addition to our hearts being sprinkled clean, our bodies have been washed in the pure water of baptism. We can approach God because He has made us clean and pure. Clean on the inside, clean on the outside. You see, the precious blood of the Son of God is more powerful than the most heinous of sins. No sin that you've ever committed or ever will commit is strong enough to withstand the power of the blood of Jesus. I'm so glad to see, Jim, that you're going to lead as our closings, our invitation song, Nothing But the Blood. Because that is so utterly true. Secondly, according to the writer of Hebrews, let us hold fast to our confession of hope. When we became Christians, we verbally confessed our faith in the Lord Jesus. Don't you remember the words of Paul? If you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord, and if you believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. Now we have to continue to clutch that confession, to hold it with a firm grip. We must, because it's on that confession that our hope depends. Especially in the letter to the Hebrews, faith is bound up very closely with hope. Listen, if you will, to the definition of faith that the author gives at the beginning of the very next chapter. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for. As we're all experiencing, except maybe for a very few of us, the aging process is cruel and unkind. It sometimes steals our life partner from us. It sometimes torments us with pain. In fact, sometimes we wonder how a loving and compassionate God would allow us to be put through the ringer. And why, oh why, hasn't Jesus returned to save us and to save all of His people? I want to tell you, we all experience sometimes what's been called the dark night of the soul. Times which try men's souls. But don't relax your grip on your confession. It's on that that your hope depends. And why can we hang on with all the strength that we can muster? It's because the Lord always keeps His promises. He's utterly reliable. Read back through the Bible, and you'll see so many promises that God has already kept. His track record has been perfect so far. No reason to doubt now that He will make good on all of His promises regarding our future. Hang on just a little longer, and your night will be obliterated by the dawning of the sun. And now thirdly, as the author of Hebrews exhorts, let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good works. Although the fullness of our salvation still lies in the future, there's plenty to do right now. There's a proverb that says, as iron sharpens iron, so does one person sharpen another. And that's the way it is with us. We are supposed to stimulate and encourage one another to love and to good works. Now, how exactly does that happen? Well, it happens for me when I see that you are committed enough to a life of love in the Christian faith that you show up at church in order to study God's Word and to praise the Lord. It happens for me when I hear you sing songs to me about the importance of loving others. It happens to me when I see you express your love for each other at the assemblies. And it especially happens for me when I see or hear about your loving deeds to each other during the week. Your enthusiasm for engaging in loving deeds stirs up the same desire in me. I'm sure that you can see how important it is that we meet together regularly and that we be involved in each other's lives. Otherwise, we can't carry out this exhortation to incite each other to loving deeds. You know, don't you, that the horse begins to run faster as he gets closer to the barn. Some of you may have actually literally experienced that. Well, something like that is supposed to happen to us. The day of Jesus' coming is drawing nearer with each passing day. And when that day does arrive, how will we act toward each other and toward others? How will we treat other people in the presence of our Savior? Well, I'll tell you, we'll love each other perfectly. We'll love our neighbor as we love ourselves perfectly. So hadn't we might as well go ahead and prepare for such? Hadn't we might as well see our behavior here and now as a kind of dress rehearsal for an eternity of perfect love? Surely, the answer is obvious. So as we await the coming of Jesus and the full measure of our salvation, let's enjoy access to the heavenly sanctuary. Let's enjoy the prerogatives of having Jesus as our great high priest over the house of God. And let's celebrate the new and living way into the very throne room of God that Jesus has opened for us. And let's do this by approaching God in worship with confident hearts, by hanging on to our initial confession of faith on which our hope depends, and by encouraging one another to immerse ourselves in lives of loving deeds. Persevere, my brothers and sisters. Persevere. Amen. Let us pray together. Oh God, what a privilege it is that through the blood of Jesus, your Son, we can come directly before you into your throne room, that we can praise your name, that we can thank you for our blessings, and that we can ask for grace to help in the time of need. Oh Lord, we praise you for admitting us into your presence and making it possible through the death and through the resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our High Priest forever. Amen. We're going to sing a song now about the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus, his death upon the cross, is what makes it possible for us to come before God without embarrassment, without shame, without fear, because the sacrifice of Jesus Christ is so powerful that it washes away all of our sins. If you need to respond to the invitation today, we encourage you to do so while we stand and sing.